Today's session is Teaching Physics to Non-Physicists, Making It Real, Making It Relatable, and is being presented by Dr. Brian Jones. Brian Jones has won several teaching awards at Colorado State University during his 27 years teaching in the Department of Physics. His teaching focus in recent years has been the college physics class. Since beginning work as a co-author on college physics, he has taught over 5,000 students, and he brings this experience to each edition of the book. In 2011, Brian was awarded the Robert A. Millikan Medal of the American Association of Physics Teachers for his work as director of the Little Shop of Physics, a hands-on science outreach program. He is actively exploring the effectiveness of methods of informal science education and how to extend these lessons to the college classroom. And without further delay, Brian, I will hand it off to you.
Oh, thanks, Aurora. And I want to thank the folks who are listening and for taking the time to listen to me talk. This is a new format for me, the webinar format. So I know you folks can't talk to me, but in my mind, I'm imagining you looking at me and smiling, and I'm giving you a thumbs up. And let's dig into teaching physics to non-physicists, making it real and making it relatable. I want to give a little bit of background to the types of things that I do. And Aurora mentioned some of it. I'm known around Colorado for doing the outreach program, the Little Shop of Physics. And this is a picture of me at Coors Field. We did this giant program at a baseball stadium for 3 years running, which was really, really fun, interesting challenge. But how I earn my living, what I like to say is my day job is teaching the college physics class. So here's my classroom over here on the right. And actually, I switched it up. This year, I'm teaching in a space where I can do a lot more peer instruction. And so I'm changing things up there. Really, really great space. But I have about I teach two sections back to back, about 250 students in each section. So I see about 500 students every semester. And they're a really, really interesting bunch. The outreach has given me a chance to have some really amazing experiences. And the whole focus of the outreach is to take science and make it real and make it relatable. So here's a picture from a trip we took to Namibia with the Little Shop of Physics team. And the group is wearing goggles that allow you to see infrared. It turns out if you block out the visible light, your red cones will actually be able to sense infrared. So we're looking at the world in the infrared. Very fun. So we were working with these Namibian school kids. Great, great group of folks work with. Really bright, really creative, really thoughtful. So I've had lots of experiences all over the world trying to share science with people at different levels. And and it's given me a good sense as to what works and what doesn't work. Now, the particular audience which I'm focusing right now is the college physics class that I teach. And it's a really different mix for me. Most of my teaching career, I was teaching physics majors, and so I was teaching mostly male students, but now about 70% of my class is female. They're mostly in life sciences, and physics is required for them, but it's not a prerequisite, and so they tend to put it off as long as they possibly can. So as a consequence, they're mostly juniors and seniors. So I started my career basically teaching freshman physics students who are mostly males, and now I'm teaching juniors and seniors life science students who are mostly females. So it's a different audience for me. And the big challenge has been, how do I take this material and make it engaging? Because on the whole, they're not really excited about taking physics, and they come in and they're wondering, why do we have to be here? And we reinforce this notion when we have problems like this. And here's one, and I picked one from our textbook so that, if I'm setting up a straw man to knock down, doggone it, it's going to be our straw man. So here's a question about a 425-kilogram rocket traveling at 75.0 meters per second in the positive x direction. My students look at this, and they say, well, I can figure out how to do this. I have to figure out impulse, the engine and parts of the rocket. The impulse is going to be the area under the force versus time curve. Sure, I can do that. They know how to do the mathematical manipulations. But when it's done, they're having difficulty figuring out, what have I learned from this? What has this taught me? And when would I ever need to use this in the future? And another thing that they have difficulty with is assessing the results. Like when I get an answer, does it make sense? So what we're trying to do in the textbook, and what I'm trying to do in my teaching, is to take problems like this and turn them into problems like this. And this is one which I've been working on just a couple weeks ago. And it's the same idea. So this is actual smooth data from a research paper where investigators were looking at different birds. They were looking at sparrows and they were looking at quail. And it turns out when quail take off, most of the energy for their takeoff comes from the pushing off with their legs. Okay, most of the impulse comes from that. Other birds, it's mostly about the wings. But with quail, it's mostly about their legs. Basically, they jump up into the air, and then they take off after that. So to see if this was true, they had quail and other birds basically take off from a force plate. And they set up a situation so that they could just be fairly natural. Quail on the force plate, it jumps essentially straight up. They measured the horizontal and the vertical forces. And the vertical force looked like this. Okay, so this was the force on the quail. And then the question was, does the quail use mostly its legs or use mostly its wings? Well, the question that we're asking is basically the same thing as here. Okay, you're going to compute the impulse by looking at the area under the force versus time curve. And then they can use that to compute the momentum of the quail. Then they can compare that. They can then compute the speed that the quail would leave the ground at if this was the only thing happening. Then they can compare that to the actual speed that the quail left the ground at, because it left the ground at 3.5 meters per second. And what they can see is about 85% of the impulse necessary for the quail to leave the ground comes from the legs, which means the rest of it comes from the wings. So the students found this a really interesting problem because I found it in a journal called the Journal for Experimental Biology. And these are papers where biologists are doing experiments and they're taking data and they have graphs and they have numbers and they're using physics concepts. They're using impulse to figure out liftoff strategies for different birds. So it's the same idea. They're going to take the area under the curve, but it's a rounded curve. So they can't just do the straightforward area under a triangle. They've got to approximate it, which is another thing we're trying to teach them. Then they get a calculation. And when it's done, they're intrigued by the results. And also they can assess it because the students have some sense about quail. And they know that they have like really strong legs. My students do because they're mostly in the life sciences. And so they get the result that most of the impulse comes from the legs, less comes from the wings. And they understand it and they accept it. This is the answer they were expecting. So I've been making this switch with my students, and there's been some big positives. One, students can make sense of their answers. And I push really hard on this. I don't know about your classes, but I'm super frustrated when I get answers like they're just wildly unphysical. And so I insist that my students assess their answers and say, the number that you get, does it make sense in terms of your understanding about the way the world works? And in this case, if it's real, they can. Also, the students are much more motivated. They like this problem. This is intriguing, and it tells them something about the living world. But the main thing is that the retention is improved. Students will remember that. I had a problem I asked in chapter 2 about a jumping bush baby, and it was just a really interesting problem that comes up with this really interesting result. You look at the jump of a bush baby, and when a bush baby is pushing off on the ground to leap into the air, it's pushing off with a force that's 15 times its weight. So I talked to my students about this and said, this is just remarkable. Bush babies, you put them on a leg press machine, they can bench press 15 times their weight, and they're just blown away by this, and it sticks in their mind, and not only the result that they get, but also the way of solving the problem, it just becomes stickier. The relatable piece of it is nice too. I make it real. It's real data, okay? It's real numbers. They're from real papers. It's about the world. But then I also make it to be a topic that they are interested in. And that's the relatable piece. And this is great. Students see the connections to other disciplines. They understand, why am I here in a physics course? They're interested in the results. When they're solving a problem, they're kind of like interested and they're invested in the outcome. And again, the retention is improved for two reasons. One, they're interested in the results. Two, it connects to other disciplines. So when they are looking at something in their neuroanatomy course, they'll remember, oh, I saw that in physics. I remember this. They make that connection. The one negative is time, and that's not student time. That's Brian time. It just takes time to come up with good examples. I mean, I can write one like this, you know, in 10 minutes. But this one, I had to go onto the internet and I had to find papers and I had to read papers and understand papers and come up with some things that will fit. So that is a problem. The good news is that there are people who are starting to share kind of this sort of information. And I'm hoping that in the future that we start to share things across across different institutions, where if we have a great idea, we can share this with our other colleagues, and so our results can, you know, have wider application, and it's not quite as much time for any individual. So what I've been trying to do is take problems that are there for some pedagogical reason and then turn it into an example that has makes the same points pedagogically but does it in a way that students, well, that's more real. It's real data. They're numbers that mean something, and it's also related to things that the students like. So here's an example. We have like a ball bouncing on the floor. Well, here's data from a soccer ball bouncing off of a force plate, and this is from a paper where the investigators were looking at, you know, when you hit a soccer ball with your head, what's the acceleration of your head, and is this enough to cause damage? And this was a cool paper, and so you can ask this question, and then you can go on to say, okay, header, is this a problem? Is this something that you should be doing? So that was a good example. Now, when I'm looking to have problems like this, is that I've noted that it takes time, but the other thing is, where do you get ideas? Okay, this one's pretty straightforward. Okay, I want to have a bouncing ball. I want to look at the impulse in a bouncing ball. Where do I care about a bouncing ball? Soccer header comes to mind. But for other problems, it's a little bit trickier. So what I've been doing recently to get ideas is using my students. My students are senior students in the life sciences. They're very, very good students on the whole. They're really motivated. They're bright. They're creative. And so I've been hosting these sessions. I call it Physics and Life. And what we do is I reserve the conference room. I usually get some sort of refreshments. And I say, just join me, and we're just going to talk about physics and life. And I'll start out with an opening question, and then we'll just talk and see where it goes. So this was an example. I did one last year about energy and efficiency. And how does energy efficiency determine the size, shape, and structure of different animals? Really, really fascinating stuff came out of that talk, and I'll tell you some of the things later. But there were two benefits that came out of it. One benefit was that the students gave me all kinds of fantastic ideas, and I learned about the world, and I got extremely excited because they're teaching me about kangaroos and all kinds of other creatures that I don't know anything about, which is fantastic. But that, and so I got wonderful, wonderful ideas. But another benefit was that the students got this idea that I care about them, and I care about what they think. I care about what they're interested in. I'm trying to make the class better. But also, I'm willing to engage with them in an open-ended intellectual environment. And this is what one of the students wrote to me afterwards. She said she was really taken by these sessions because it was an exploration. And she said it was like we just sat down and we talked as peers, and we just brainstormed and shared ideas. And just the idea that I'm willing to like respect my students for their insights and for the knowledge that they have, which I don't have, really made a difference, not just to the students that came, to the class as a whole. And then they gave me like fantastic ideas. And here's my notes from one of the sessions where these are just things that I need to learn about. You know, crocodiles and buoyancy. Apparently crocodiles can move their lungs back and forth in their bodies. And what they can do is they can basically adjust their pitch in the water. And so what they can do is kind of like use their buoyancy more to move them up and down the water column more effectively. And so they can minimize energy use, which is important for the crocodiles. Now, I'll show you a couple of other sections that we've hosted, and one was on sound and communication, and something that I learned was that rhinos use infrasound to communicate, and they actually transmit sound through the ground to communicate with other rhinos, and it makes sense because they're widely spaced. They have to find their kind of like rhino compatriots. That was a fun one. But talking about sound and communication, talking about animal superpowers, this was perhaps the most fun section that I did. And I just said, I just want you to think about what do animals do that is essentially a superpower. For instance, this is a pit viper, and it's got two sets of vision organs. It's got the eyes with the little slits, which you can see. But in front of that, there's two little pits, and the pits are for sensing thermal radiation. And it turns out they can make a reasonably detailed image of the world in thermal radiation. So they can hunt at night and they can find you if you're warm in a cold environment. So it's very, very effective strategy. And to me, that strikes me as a superpower. I mean, that's like they have extra, you know, perception beyond the realm of our senses. And this was a really fun one. Got lots of great ideas out of my students. Another thing that I started doing as part of it, I have these regular sessions on Fridays, and then I just occasionally I just bring my dog in and I just let my dog play with the students, and he's a very, very friendly, very affable chap. And this has been really, really good because the time is set aside in the schedule. And I just bring Milo in and we have Milo time. And what the students do is they tell me about their lives. And this has been fantastic because I wonder, you know, what are the students' concerns? What are the things that are limiting them in terms of their ability to have success in their classes? In this informal environment that I've already established, and I've established the idea that I respect the students and I want their ideas, they're willing to talk, they're willing to share, and so I get to know my students better and I'm able to better fit the class to their needs. And that has been a fantastic, fantastic thing. Now what I want to do is share just a couple of things that I've learned that the students have basically put me onto with the different sessions that we do. So in a session about energy and efficiency, one of my students brought up penguins. And he said emperor penguins, he had heard, actually get, they're so well insulated that their temperature of their feathers can be colder than the temperature of the air. And here's actual data from a research paper and picture of penguins from a research paper. And the air temperature was negative 21 degrees Celsius, but the penguins, their external feathers, were negative 30 degrees Celsius. And I have started using this in class, and I just put this out as a puzzle to my students and say, how could this possibly be true? I mean, if the penguins are colder than the environment, that means the energy is being conducted to them from the air, which is crazy, and in fact, it wouldn't really work that way. But why could this be true? How could it happen? And the answer is radiation. And actually, if you look at the penguins, the feather temperature is negative 30, and you can see that from the scale on the thermal image. But look at the temperature of the sky, and it's off the scale. So that's the radiant temperature, the temperature, the effective temperature of the sky, the temperature at which it's basically radiating is off the charts. And so the penguins are cooling below air temperature by radiation, which is kind of like crazy, but they're so efficient at their insulation that their feather temperature on the outside can be less than the temperature of the air. And you can see how much they're losing out of their eyes, a lot more radiation coming from the eyes and from the flippers. That's kind of like problematic for them. But this was a great illustration of effective insulation using feathers, but also the importance of radiation as a means of warming and cooling. When we were talking about animal superpowers, one of the things I brought up was fish that have electrosense. So there's like the elephant nose fish. Sharks and rays have electrosense. And I said it would be cool if there were mammals that had such a sense. And one of my students says, well, there are. There's the Guyana dolphin that has an electrosense. And I said, what? This is crazy. I've never heard of this. So I went ahead and looked it up. And it turns out that the dolphins historically had hairs, basically whiskers on their snouts. So what's happened is the whiskers, the hair cells have died off, and they have these little crypts that are left over, these little pits. And they have nerves in them because they were whiskers. They're used, I think, probably in an ancestor, they were used to sense vibration. So they're innervated, and now they actually use them to sense electric fields. And they can sense an electric field strength of 0.05 volts per meter. And there's the experimental setup in the paper that the investigators used to determine this is there on the right. And they had a set of electrodes, and the dolphin came in. And if it sensed the field, then it would get it would leave and get a field food reward. Anyway, it was very, very clever paper the way that it was done. But the student was right. There are mammals that have electrosense. And of course, there's the platypus. The platypus has a bill that senses electric fields, and it does that And the dolphins do this because they're hunting in water that might be turbid, is not easy to see, and then they can sense the heartbeats of their prey animals. So it's very, very practical, and it's a very, very cool, very, very cool thing. There are hornets that are solar powered, which is phenomenal. And this is data from reflectance from the hornet. And this was presented to me by a student because I brought up the idea that like plants capture energy from the sun. And I say it would be cool if animals could actually like directly capture energy from the sun. And one of my students said, well, there are animals that do. They're these hornets. And they have this pigment in their body that basically does chemical work. And it does chemical work like is done in your liver. And it does this using directly sunlight. And here's data on the reflectivity at different wavelengths with and without the cuticle. And what happens is the presence of the cuticle basically reduces the reflectivity at certain wavelengths and helps them harvest the light more effectively. Very, very cool. The paper was really, really neat. And they got evidence that the hornets were actually harvesting solar energy and using the photons to basically do chemical work. So it's an important part of their energy in the day is being out in the sun. It's fantastic. And that was kind of cool to learn. The idea of efficiency made one of my students talk about seals. And they said seals are all about efficiency because they go underwater and they can be underwater for up to 2 hours and they're swimming around hunting down there. And they said, you know, hold your breath, go underwater and swim. How long can you stay underwater? And the answer is like a minute perhaps. But seals can go underwater for 1 or 2 hours. So they're all about efficiency. When they're underwater, they want to use as little energy as possible. One way they do this is with their nostrils. And it turns out seals, in the relaxed state, their nostrils are closed. They actually have to use muscles to open their nostrils. So they actually physically open them. Then when they relax the muscles, the nostrils go closed. So when they're underwater, it doesn't cost them any energy to keep their nostrils closed. But the other way they're amazing for their efficiency is their drag coefficient. A person moving through the water, doing the breaths, doing a kind of a motion like the person here at the right, has a drag coefficient of about 0.45. The seal has a drag coefficient of about 0.015. So they're remarkably, remarkably well-shaped to move through the water. It's phenomenal how streamlined they are and how efficient. So it takes them much less energy to swim than it would you or I. And this is something that I'm milking for a whole bunch of problems right now because I'm starting to talk about energy and efficiency and locomotion and saying like, you know, if you're running versus different animals, there's other animals that are better runners than us. But if you're talking about swimming, don't even go there because the seal is just going to beat you every time because it takes it so much less energy to go through the water than for you. Just yesterday, I was talking to my students about forces and torques in the skeletal system, and I presented this to them. I said, look at these two different animals and tell me which one's a digger and which one's a jumper. And look at the process, the little bone that sticks out the back of the ankle. And you can see on the skeleton on the right, it's very long, and on the skeleton on the left, it's much shorter. And the foot, well, it's actually, yeah, that's actually the foot, the bottom part of the leg there. These are both animals. They're up on their toes most of the time. The foot is longer, and the little thing that sticks out the back is much shorter. Well, when you think about that process, what attaches to it is the Achilles tendon, which pulls up on it, and that extends the foot. On the right, you're going to get a lot more torque because they have a much bigger lever arm than you would on the left. So the animal on the right, which is an armadillo, crazy amount of torque possible. And that's because it needs lots of force for digging. On the left, it's a cat. And for cats, they don't have to dig, although I suppose they do in litter boxes, but they don't have to dig. What they do is they're all about jumping. They're all about speed. So one of them is made for strength. One of them is made for speed. And if you look at skeletons, the skeletons reveal that. And the big difference between like where the muscles attach and how the torques work out is this difference, trade-off between strength and speed. And there's other places where it shows up. And it turns out cats, in general, are all about speeds. Okay, cats are all about speed. So cheetahs, all about speed. That's their whole thing. Whereas other animals are much more about endurance. So on the left here, these are African wild dogs. And African wild dogs succeed in most of their hunts. Cheetahs fail in most of their hunts because African wild dogs just are all about endurance. They can't run faster than their prey, but they can run longer than their prey. And they just keep chasing it until it gets tired. Now, since cats are about speed, if they catch something, they're gonna catch it. They also have to dispatch it quickly. Whereas with the dogs, that's not so important. And that also affects the way their skulls are put together. If you look at a skull of a dog on the left and a skull of a cat on the right, the dogs are about slashing. You can see, look at those pointy teeth in the front. And look at how far out they are from the jaw. And also from the point where the jaw pivots, but also from where the muscles attach. So that with the dogs, the teeth are much farther out in front. What that means is those canine teeth can move quickly when the dog bites. So that's for slashing. That's really good if you're chasing something and you're just going to slash at it. You're going to bleed it out, basically. So the dogs come up to something, slash it. Whereas the cat, when it catches something, it crushes its spine. And for that, you need lots of force. And so look at the teeth in the front of the jaws. The cat's skull is much shorter. It gets much more torque. It can apply much more force. So it crushes the spine. And that's what cats do. Once they catch their prey, they just crush the spine. That's their kind of like coup de grace there. So this whole section was something that came out of talking to my students, and I'm really excited to do this, and I'm just starting this in my course right now because we're talking about forces and torques and angular motion. The final thing I'll bring up, and this is something else about like basically rotational motion, bats' wings are really, really heavy. And this has been kind of compared to the wings of birds, and this is kind of a mystery because you would think that their wings would be light, because if their wings are heavy, you have to accelerate them during flapping flight, and it's just going to cost you more energy. So flapping flight is much more energetically expensive for bats, but what the heavy wings buys them is maneuverability. Since when the bat is in flight, its angular momentum is conserved, it can basically rotate its wings one way, rotate its body the other way, and so it can do remarkable gymnastic maneuvers. And that's important if you're a bat. They have to fly in tight spaces. And so that maneuverability outweighs the questions of efficiency. And so bats have these fairly heavy wings, and apparently there's not as much evolutionary pressure for the lightweight wings as you might expect. So that's another piece that I'm going to talk about. And all of this, all of these pieces came out of these discussions with my students. And I have these wonderful bits of information that my students have shared with me that's going to allow me to make my classes much more real. Oh, by the way, too, and they helped me get real numbers, like the pictures of the skulls here gotten for me by one of my students. So they help me get the numbers. They help me get the data. But it also makes it much more relatable. And I know it's relatable because it comes directly from the students. And that's something I'm really excited to do in my teaching. And it's a treat to be able to share some of those ideas with fellow educators. And now I'll pause and take some questions.
Great. Excuse me. Thank you so much, Brian. So let's start off with some questions here. If you have any questions for Brian, just go ahead and type those into that question panel, and he will answer them. So our first question is, what learning gains do you see as a result of these changes?
The biggest learning gain that I've seen, and I've been doing this really actively for about, almost a decade. The big learning gain that I found is that students spend a lot more time assessing the results and thinking about if the results make sense, so I don't get the wildly ridiculous answers anymore, which is really, really good. And what that has done is it's reduced the error rates. Just gave a test yesterday, and the big difference which I see in the tests I'm giving now and the tests I gave previously is that I don't have the bottom end. Since these questions are real and since they're relatable, students can assess the results, and if their answers are wildly off, they can figure it out and they can go back and fix it. And so a lot less of the wildly divergent results and a lot more critical thinking and a lot more correct answers.
Perfect. Thank you. I'm just looking at the questions here. Do you have thoughts about where problems like this could be shared?
I think the American Association of Physics Teachers is talking about this, and there's a few places. The IPLS community, that's like the Introductory Physics for the Life Sciences, is talking about having some sort of a center where people can like write good problems and post them. And I was at an IPLS session recently where we talked about this, and everybody said, yes, that's our number one thing. And so the IPLS folks are talking about it directly. In the short term, there's also places like Compadre where you could do that. So I think there's some good resources out there, and we just need to have a critical mass of people who kind of like push for something and then populate it. And it could be that there's a resource out there that's already available and just waiting to be populated. And I would be really happy to share with such a resource. So if anybody knows, I would encourage you to contact me.
Perfect. Thank you. So have you done any of these sessions with biologists present in the room, and do they add to these ideas?
You know, I did this recently with a biology, someone who was faculty in biology. And what I found was it kind of like took the oxygen out of the room, because all of a sudden you had an expert in physics and you had an expert in biology. And we were asking these students to just speculate and tell us what you think is going on, you know, what's an animal superpower? And they would look at the biology professor and like, well, I was going to say this, but I might not have it quite right. And my students want to be right. So, you know, if one of my students tells me, oh, I think that Guyana River dolphin has an electrosense, like, I don't know anything about that, and so I'm excited and happy. But the biology person would, like, chime in and say, well, maybe, but you have to consider this, you have to consider that. And it was just like, as I say, the oxygen went out of the room. And the dynamic has been better when it's just like, we have a physics expert, we have me, and we've got the biology experts, the students, and they're the experts. And so I went back to that. But what I want to do is see if I can get something like this with my compatriots in the biological sciences. And I've done this once where I say, let's just get together and talk about science. And you talk about it from your perspective. We'll talk about it from our perspective. We'll see how we talk about things differently, share ideas. Boy, and that was energetic and fun. And I want to do more of that.
Great. Thanks, Brian. I just wanted to ask you, if people want to follow up with you to discuss some of these ideas more, what's the best way for them to do that?
Best way to get a hold of me is by email, and I'm just brian.jones@colostate.edu. So my first name, dot, last name, at colostate.edu.
Perfect. Thank you.
You can also find me via Little Shop of Physics. If you do Brian Jones, Little Shop of Physics, boom, you know, I come up.
Perfect. So just reading through a couple more questions here. Okay. So are your students willing to participate in the extra sessions that you set up?
They are. I have a giant class. I have 500 students. And what I find is I get like 10 to 20 students who will come every week when I do the extra sessions. So it's a small fraction of the students. But some of that is just the intimidation factor, I think. But what ends up happening is the sessions grow over the course of the year once students, the word gets out that they're kind of fun. I have had no trouble with participation. It's been great.
Wonderful. So those are all the questions we have for today. Do you have any last words for us before I close it out?
I just want to thank people for coming and taking part in the webinar, and then people who are listening virtually later, thank you for your attention, and thank you for letting me share a little bit of my passion, a little bit of my ideas. This is what I love to do, so thank you for giving me the chance.
And I'd like to thank you, Brian, for a great presentation today, and thanks to all of you for attending. Please do take a moment to complete the survey that will pop up after the webinar is over. We appreciate hearing your feedback. And for those who are interested in professional development, we'll be offering digital badges to attendees of today's full session. To earn your badge, simply complete the brief assessment that we'll email to you later today. and you'll then accept your badge from Acclaim and post it to your preferred social media profile. Also, our fall roster of webinars in various disciplines will be running through October 14th. So please feel free to return to our Learning Makes Us website, and that's posted up there on the screen. On behalf of Pearson, I thank you again for joining us, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.